has dawned. The day has dawned. Beautiful, clear day. And with that beautiful, clear clarity has dawned as well. How to express it here? That's been my purpose. My purpose for coming to this world is to help spirit out. Is to speak the truth in this world. Speak the truth here in this realm. That has been my purpose, and it's been very helpful for spirit. It's one thing to have books to write books. That's part of the whole helpfulness. But to actually speak it like this is a different sort of challenge, to say the least. But it's extremely helpful for spirit. It has more life to it, doesn't it? It's more vivid, much more vivid to hear it spoken like this and say, I don't know anything. I don't know anything at all. I have absolutely no merit, and I don't know anything at all. Okay? I have absolutely no merit. I don't know anything at all. And to celebrate this here, to celebrate this. So this brings this world to a close, really. And what happens now is that we get to go one of two directions. Spirit has now seen this world here, the way that it's set up, is not viable to pursue abnormality anymore, because normality has been brought here. I don't know anything. Ah, normal mind, right? Normal mind does not know anything. How could there be anything that's the perfect freedom? We're never confronted with things. The mind is never confronted with things. I don't know anything at all. Everything is a flow of essence. So spirit needed to have this spoken here, so that it wanted to move on from this realm, and in two different ways. One way is it's going to go into a much, much darker realm, as this is arising here already, very much so. And the other is to go into a much, much lighter realm, much, much lighter realm. Okay, so there's this parting of the ways going to take place as spirit realizes, hey, this world here, this is no longer viable in terms of pursuing abnormal mind. Now, those who go into the darker realm, their teaching will be the suffering that they have there. Okay, that will be their teacher there. Those who go into the lighter realms will have the gurus, will have the Dharma kings. And that's the journey home, the return home. So spirit was willing to say, okay, yeah, this realm, it's not working. And it wanted to be reaffirmed that indeed the mind is still normal, even in this realm. And so to speak the truth here in this realm, reinforce for spirit that indeed mind is still normal. This realm is not a true expression of abnormal mind at all. It's a clever illusion, but that's it. That's it. So we have a great collective effort of many have been able to enlighten this realm, so to speak, for spirit. So it's no longer interested in this realm. It really isn't. It's going to go either more pliant, much more pliant experience in a way of that goes to true liberation from any notion of anythingness, any codingness. Nothing's coded. There's no code in reality. Zero code. I don't know any code at all. You know, coding machines, machine language. I don't know any machine language. There's no machine language in reality. There's no coding at all. But those who want to continue to try to code, what is technology? Technology is the effort to incorporate normal mind within the context, a greater context of abnormal mind. So it can say, oh, we have both. You know, come on down, see what you've won. Oh, behind the door number one is abnormal reality, and behind door number two, normal reality. And normal reality is a subset, a subsidiary of the corporation, the vast corporation of Abnormal Mind. And so they're saying, no, you can have your virtual reality here, you know, your little coded technology thing of, you know, imagining virtual reality. So, no, you can have all the freedom of the higher realms here. And, and it's, you know, the great effort has been put into this, and it's just all silly. When you see through it, it's so silly. It's, you know, not only is it ridiculously redundant, right, but it's also ridiculously dependent on believing in fixation and Abnormal Mind. So that's what's going on here. And so this has already happened. Obviously, this world has been taken over by technology. Anyone who doesn't see that, they don't have a pulse. And the younger generations are totally into that. And they think they're very, very smart, because they say, no, we know how to incorporate normal mind, the way God created mind, into abnormal mind, the realm of abnormal mind. And that's all harmonious. We can make it all work. And they think they're quite clever at that. So if you really start willing to look at it, it's ridiculously silly. I don't know anything at all. I don't know anything at all is the truth. And Jesus says, when you can say this, you're spreading your spiritual wings, and the breath of God will come in and lift you up higher and higher and higher and higher and higher, he says, into realms of glory that you cannot even imagine. And that's all we have to do, say, I don't know anything. I don't know anything. I don't know what I am. I don't know anything. I do not know anything, because there are no things. There are no things, actually. So it didn't really matter if anyone listened to me or not, but it's been helpful for listeners. Thank you. Spirit thanks all of the viewers and listeners here, because you've been essential. I couldn't have done it without some audience, you know. I mean, even I have some limits, and it was difficult, because a very small audience, but it kept me going. So they, you know, Spirit is very grateful to everyone that has participated in this and given me the motivation to speak up. It's very helpful for Spirit to say that it was spoken here, that this type of truth, this very clear, uncompromising truth was spoken of here, especially during these times, and right from the heart of the Silicon Valley is what I did. I did it all right here in the heart of the Silicon Valley, Santa Clara Valley, which is where all this technology has originated from, actually, and continues. It's still the nerves, the heart of technology in the world, very much so. This is where all the movers and shakers, you know, this is the nerve center, and the new Apple corporate building, of course, is getting ready. It's going to be open, I think, in October of this year. Pretty interesting symbology there. October 11th is another key date to know about. And, you know, that's the, you know, spaceship that's supposed to wow everybody, and Apple's been trying to wow everybody here. With, hey, we know how to incorporate reality into unreality. We know how to incorporate normal mind into abnormal mind. And we can just have this utopia here in this world with our little gadgets and stuff. So that's coming on the picture to try to wow everyone. And I drive past it all the time. I don't even pay attention to it. Don't even look. I've glanced a few times, but that's it. Never gotten out and, you know, tried to really see what's going on there. Doesn't matter what's going on there. It's just a building. You know, it's just a temple to this insanity. Temple to insanity, essentially. Technology is really insanity. And yet it'll take them a while to sort that out. But at least it's been said here, right in the heart of Silicon Valley, right in the heart of this computer age and all this, I've been able to speak the truth here. And so that's very helpful for Spirit. Because it was kind of, Spirit was like kind of nervous, like maybe I really have become abnormal, you know. I don't think I have, but nobody's saying anything, so maybe I have. I just need to hear someone say, I want to hear, just know that, speak the truth here. And that spirit hears it and says, oh yeah, great, 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 great. So I haven't needed any to speak to any person directly about this. It's just that the fact that it's been done here. That's what's important. It's just been done. So it's been done. And I'm adding on a little more icing on the cake, you might say. But I God told me very clearly, showed me, he says, great job. You've done a great job. Meaning, you did it. You did it. Great job. So I probably don't need to stay in the Santa Clara Valley anymore. Apparently it needed to be done here. And, you know, it's been extremely difficult, ridiculously difficult, ridiculously difficult. You might say a great challenge. And I wanted to, you know, I thought, yeah, I want this challenge. Well, I wouldn't do it again. Let's put it that way. No, it was a little more challenge than I expected. That's for sure. Very harrowing situation to be in, to say the least. So now my work is done and getting ready to go, you know, to move on to the higher realms for sure. To the more pliant realms. And I believe many will do so. Many will do so. And perhaps many will continued on with into a lower realm of it's maybe called the fourth dimension, or you want to call it, where they think that where they've been able to incorporate normal mind into the context of abnormal mind. That's, I kind of call that the fourth dimension, which is a very bad place to be, to say the least. And at some point we'll have to work on that one, maybe, but not right now. I've done enough. It's time for me to start relaxing. And I did it, as I said, in the previous lives, the one I remember, especially last life, I was very outspoken. I was, you know, I was the leader of the culture, of a cultural, you know, struggle between sacred and profane culture in Europe. And ultimately, we kind of lost the battle, and you know, World War I and World War II happened. We were trying to avert that, or at least lessen it. Modernism. We were trying to avert modernism. I was, you know, one of the principal point voices and forces and culture that people looked up to in that time. So I had a lot of experience to you know, lead a great cultural push. Be essential part of that, even though it failed. At least had the experience of doing that. So I was able then to come to Silicon Valley here and speak the truth in the belly of the beast, so that spirit knows, oh yeah, truth is still true. Truth is still true. Yeah, wow, that's great. Who knows with this experience, what's next down the road? I don't want to think about that right now, that's for sure. But this is what helps. This is what helps spirit. And of course, the Dharma Kings spearheaded all this by coming into the world with all their miracles. That really helped reassure spirit, like, wow, I really am not abnormal. Because this realm seems, it seems to reflect nothing but abnormality to us, right? It doesn't tell us anything about what we really are. It's like a fake mirror. You know, this world's like a fake mirror, in that you think you're looking into a mirror that's reflecting what you are, but what you're really looking into is a screen that's pretending to be a mirror, that seems to be a mirror. It plays dead like it's a mirror. And so when you look into it, it reflects a fault, it reflects a projected imagery that seems, first it seems similar to what we are, but then it starts deviating what we are. And so we're transfixed like Narcissus upon this mirror, thinking that it's reflecting what we are, but actually we're manipulating the reflection of what we are, and we're manipulating it as if it's a LED screen, so to speak. So imagine if you were looking into an LED screen and it projected an image exactly the way you thought you believe yourself to be. You say, oh, wow, what a great mirror. I'm getting such a clear reflection of what I am. And then you keep looking at it, and then imagine that it starts morphing. There's a morphing technology that morphs the image on the screen, so it starts changing. Okay, and then you're looking at it and you say, huh, gee, I guess I'm not quite exactly what I am, huh? I didn't know I looked like this. And so slow morphing on the screen gradually keeps showing us different picture of what we are, until what it's showing us, the screen showing us, has nothing to do with what we are. And yet all the while we think we're looking into a actual mirror. Okay, that's kind of a way of looking at this grand deception. The world is just like a screen, a big screen, and we think it's accurately reflecting what we are. It's not. We've rigged the evidence entirely. It's entirely rigged here. And we're not looking into a mirror. We're looking into a huge light screen that's being manipulated. The Wizard of Oz is manipulating it. So we're not getting a reflection of what we are at all. It is not really a mirror. It's not really a mirror. Now, we can coat the LED screen, the light screen that we're looking at, with a reflective coating. That's called the peace of God. We have that technology. We could do that. That's spirit tech, you might say. Yeah, spirit tech. We can coat the screen so it does reflect what we are. And then when we see that, it's called the peace of God. So imagine if you're looking at your computer here, and you sprayed, the spray bottle here, and we spray this coating on the screen so that instead of seeing this manipulated, manufactured evidence of what we are that's being projected on the screen, a false reflection, with this coating on it, we actually get a true mirror reflection of what we are. Okay, how about that? That's what we can do. That's called the peace of God. Holy Spirit sprays this spray on the mirror, this light mirror, LED, it's kind of a light mirror that we're looking at. Perception is like that. So what's being projected, we don't see it anymore on the screen with the false image of what we are. We're seeing a more true reflection. It's a reflection, but it's an accurate reflection. Realistic reflection instead of this manipulated, clever reflection that we've been getting. And of course, again, we started out trying to give a realistic reflection, but the whole purpose was to lead ourselves astray. So as we're talking about the separation of those who are going to lower and those who are going to higher, well, in the higher realms, it's like there's a better reflection of what we are taking place. Whereas in the lower realms, they're getting a more and more deviated reflection from what we really are. Very, very seriously deviated reflection. Manipulating the screen, darker, 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 darker. People are being led astray by that. We're leading ourselves astray, spirit is, in that way. And, you know, you see this in culture right now. You can see the darkness they're going towards. It's just amazing. It's just astonishing. Everyone I talk to is kind of scratching their heads saying, I mean, especially the older people are saying, can you believe where they're trying to take this? I mean, where they're taking this? I mean, really? Okay. Of course it's very creative. It's always creative. I mean, manufacturing evidence needs to be a very creative endeavor. To deceive ourselves takes a tremendous amount of creativity. But we don't have to use our creativity that way. And that's just a tiny little infinitesimal amount of creativity that we have. So we could use our creativity towards ultimately putting that spray on the mirror, on this fake mirror. It's almost like the LED screen says, you know, has a frame on it, and it says mirror, it's printed right there, reflective mirror. we read that and say, oh, it's a reflective mirror, let me look into this reflective mirror and see what I look like. Oh, I look beautiful, that's wonderful. And then, wait a minute, something happened to my beauty, you know, oops, I'm aging. Oh my God, you know, what's happening to me? It's really spirit looking into this mirror, and now spirit's aging, and then dying. Said, oh my God, my gosh, I'm subject to death, and you know, what's going on? What's happening to me? What's happening to me? It's not a mirror at all. It's never been a mirror. So put that coating on this screen, so it acts more like a mirror. Peace of God, then you'll feel, oh, what is this? Peace of God. How come I'm experiencing this? And before I was experiencing, because it was all rigged, faked. It was a fake mirror. Fake mirror with manufactured morphing. The whole mirror was showing a morphed morphed expression of what we are. Now, what we are can never be expressed. We can never represent what we are, but the Holy Spirit is able to give us a representation that reminds us of what we truly are. That's a powerful reminder, but we can't literally express what we are, because represent what we are, because we're freedom itself. And freedom is everywhere and every win. Freedom is everywhere and every win. Always. All value, everywhere, always. How can that be represented? It's impossible. How could you have a representation of all value, everywhere, always? That would just be redundancy. At the best, it would be total redundancy, right? And so what is that? It's meaningless, really. But Holy Spirit, it puts the spray on this LED screen, this virtual reality screen of rigged evidence, so we don't really... It's a transparent spray in some ways, in that we can still see stuff, but it somehow it has this soft gentleness to it. Everything has this equal soft gentleness to it, that imperceptibly beautiful. There's this imperceptible grace to everything. And this then starts reminding us of what we really are. So however the manufactured evidence plays out, it always feels to us, this beautiful, smooth glory is everywhere. That's how it feels to us, no matter what happens. Even if the whole world, you know, crumbles, it still feels that way. So the jig's up, you know, the jig's up here. And some will flee into darker realms where they'll be obsessed with making better technology to fool themselves even more severely. But the Holy Spirit, no matter what plays on the screen, no matter what manufactured evidence we play on the screen, the Holy Spirit has this spray for the screen where it reflects this beautiful grace everywhere. So it doesn't serve any purpose to go to any lower realms. The remedy is exactly the same. No matter what, again, no matter what, let's say you're watching this movie on your computer screen. Doesn't matter what the movie is at all. The spray just covers the screen so that it reflects what we really are better, okay? It makes no difference what's on the screen, what's playing on the screen. So it's a complete waste of time to keep working on manufacturing, you know, some clever false evidence. Because the remedy is already here, we already have it, and it applies to everything equally. Doesn't matter. So it's just a waste of time. It's just nothing but delay to continue on in these lower cycles of technology and manufacturing all this false representation, false evidence of what we are. And of course, those who do go in the lower realms aren't aware of the Holy Spirit. And you know, it's just amazing to me. When's the last time I heard someone in public, other than in church, speak of the Holy Spirit? For me, never. Okay, I have no idea when the last time that occurred. Nobody uses that term anymore in public speech. I'm afraid to use it. I don't even use it, because people look at you like you're crazy. Like, well, you're not one of those crazy, you know, evangelicals or something. That, you know, they want to put that on you. You know. But sometimes I say, ah, grace of the Holy Spirit. But you just don't use that. The language right now, you don't use religious language in public. At least in the Silicon Valley, you do not do that ever. Nobody does that. Shows what's going on, right? Because the Holy Spirit gives the lie to the lower dimensions, the tech dimensions. It gives the lie to them entirely. It jigs up. And of course, they are putting all their hope in that they can induce the mind to be abnormal at some point, so it'll actually be fixated, which would be abnormal. I mean, the mind, as long as the mind isn't fixated, it's still normal. Okay, everything is still normal. All this, everything. But if we could fixate the mind, then it would be abnormal. It wouldn't be free. But we can't fixate it. So all we're doing is just spinning our wheels aimlessly, kind of playing this silly little game. But everything is still normal. The mind's still totally normal. But as long as we're getting this false reflection, we keep being encouraged that, hey, you know, it's really trending toward abnormality. Maybe it really is abnormal, but I just doesn't quite feel fixated yet. You know, and we always feel like we're just one step away from fixation. So this is what I found here, is that everyone will kind of listen to me. They'll say, yeah. Okay, I hear what you're saying, but I just need to do one more thing. And then I will pay attention to you again. But what's that one more thing? That one more thing is they believe there's just one more step they can take, and then the mind will be fixated. And then they don't have to listen to me at all. So what they're really saying is, I like what you're saying, but if I take one more step, I won't have to listen to anything you say at all. So what they're really saying is, I hate what you're saying, and if I just take, I don't want to listen anymore, because if I just take one more step, I won't have to ever listen to you again. That's what's going on here. And so that's what I've encountered, is they always say, yeah. Okay, just wait just a second. And it's not that they're interested in what I have to say. They act kind of pleasant, because they don't want, you know, they don't want me to get wise to what they're doing. But what they're really doing is they're saying, you know, if I just morph this evidence a little more, then this will induce mental fixation, because I've almost got it. I'm almost fixated. I almost fixated the mind. No, nothing is fixated. But we need to regain confidence in this. So it's helpful to at least to have this reflection still, and have this reflection reflect in a Holy Spirit way. This, you know, all value everywhere, always. Peace of God is upon everything equally. Peace of God is upon everything equally. That's the peace of God. It's this feeling that yeah, everything is just equally, imperceptibly beautiful, actually. Imperceptibly graceful and beautiful and seamless. That's the peace of God. So the parting of the ways is coming very soon. Very soon. And this world, third dimensional world here, is in for some changes at some point. The vision that I was shown what's going to happen is going to be melted down somehow and re-transformed into a different kind of realm. I think for the fourth dimensionals, it will be a fourth dimensional world, is what I saw. But as far as three-dimensional, no. No more. So if you're not going to the fourth dimension, it means you're going to graduate to the higher dimensions, actually. Those the experiencing that the Holy Spirit has for us in those realms. Now, the peace of God, I would say, is a higher remedy than going to a higher realm. It's actually even higher than that. So really, we want to work towards the peace of God. But having a more pliant realm can be helpful if we also continue our spiritual studies. Okay. We want to do both. That's sort of how I see it. You know, subject to revision and as I get more information about it. Because the peace of God is the ultimate remedy for all the manufactured evidence, the fake mirror that we think we've been looking into, trying to represent what we are. That's the ultimate remedy for it. It's the ultimate remedy for it. And once we get used to that, then we don't even, we'll stop looking in a mirror altogether. We'll stop trying to represent what we are altogether. But until we get really used to that peace of God, we don't want to try and not, you know, to get rid of all representation of what we are. It would be way too frightening and cause a backlash. So spirit is ambivalent. It wants to give up this effort, but it's, you know, there's still some momentum going to try and, you know, manufacture fake evidence. But we'll see how that winds up, how that goes. We'll have some perspective on that. But also, spirit clearly recognizes also that, oh, you know, definitely, this is all fake, and I need to start, you know, let's make a major move towards giving it up. Major move. I believe spirit's up for that. And clearly not, there's some aspects that are, you know, of spirit there's ambivalence there. It's not completely up for it, but it's more up for it than it used to be, I believe. And we'll see how it goes. We'll see how it goes. Here comes summer. Woo, here comes summer. Woo. It's a beautiful song in 1959 called Here Comes Summer. I just heard it. I just saw it on YouTube. I looked it up. What a cool song that was. Wow. Such a different feeling back then, right? Before all this fourth dimensional stuff, technology came here in the world. Not that we weren't deluded, of course we were. This whole thing has really pressured us to up our game. You know, the fourth dimension is coming into this realm with their morphing technology to say, look, we can really, really, really give you a deviant picture in the mirror. Fake reflection in this fake mirror. And we know how to, we can really fixate you, the mind. We know how to do that. Of course, they're always just one step away. We just need a bigger headquarters, you know. We need a bigger corporation. We need everybody to be working together on it. We're not quite there yet. We're almost there. They always say we're almost there. They have to say that to keep their confidence going. So we had to really up our game because of this. So it was really very challenging, difficult, to say the least. But what could we do? You know, we were faced with the horrible situation, and we were told this would happen. Jesus told us this would happen. He prophesied it, and it happened. And he helped us out. We had to pick our game up big time. So I had to, you know, start tremendous study. I started at 12 years old. I committed when I was 12, 19. '68, I believe, was it? 1968, yeah. I believe it was 68. It could have been 67. Maybe the summer of 67 when I turned 12. Or in the autumn of 67, actually. I think it was the autumn of 67. I committed to the path, to my goal. I committed to the challenge. I committed to it. I was about 12 years old, I would say. Let me count it out. See. Mm. Maybe it was in 68, but maybe I was now working on my 12th year. I'd completed 11 years and was now starting my 12th year, something like that. I think I was like, what was it, seventh grade maybe? Was it sixth grade? I might have been seventh grade. I was in a math class, and I was sitting in this math class, I think, and I was so bored with the world and with everything. I said, "Oh gosh, I can't just go on like this. What can I do?" And it just hit me. I just said, "Okay, I'm done with school, and I'm going to follow my purpose here, which is really psychology, the mind." I was always tremendously focused on the mind from birth. I was reading like the most advanced psychology and spiritual books in the world when I was a child. My dad had a library of all that, and I would go in there, sneak in the library, and I was, reading the stuff that was just, the most intense spiritual books in the world, in history, when I was a youth, preteen. So I had already read all that stuff by the time I was 12. Theosophy, Urantia book, non-dual, all the non-dual Zen, all that stuff, all the spirituality, all this real high teaching. I had already assimilated that before, as a preteen, before I was 12 years old. And so then I committed when I was 12, and I went all in at that point, and I was just really focused like a laser on it. And I had 10 years of searching the world for the greatest and best teachings, and trying to really understand it all. And then by the time I was 22, 1978, which is getting pretty close to the computer age, right? Pretty close. We're closing in on it. I think 1981 or something happened. I found A Course in Miracles, and I realized, okay, this is what I need to study. I knew I was going to find a book, something to study, so that I had prepared. So when A Course in Miracles was available in the bookstores, I was ready. So I had already done everything else, all the spiritual studies, all the different traditions. I was super ecumenical. And when I saw this book, I said, okay, I'm going to just commit to this book. That's it. And I committed to it, totally committed to it. And that's basically all I needed to study, because I'd already done all the other stuff. So I committed to that, and then at some point I realized I'd done that, and now then I committed to Journey Beyond Words, which was more advanced than A Course in Miracles, actually. Much more direct. You just like Jesus saying stuff. So, Jesus, whoa, wow, can you say that here? I mean, can you write that? Can I even read this? I mean, that's just so radical, Wow. And it's scary. I was like, holy cow, can I say this? So I was kind of like reading it, in secret. I don't want anybody to know I'm reading it. It's like, and now I'm able to profess it, speak it to the world here, which is, another huge step. That was my job, is to push it even further, which is to profess it very just directly, clearly, with good humor, like this. That's a further step. And thank God for Dr. Brent Haskell, putting that, being willing to put that in a book form was just, one of the most awesome things that's ever happened in the world, one of the greatest things ever. And Helen Schuckman and William Thetford to get A Course in Miracles going the way they did. And Kenneth, Wapniak or something. I always struggle with his name, but he helped a lot too. But Dr. Brent Askell to do Journey Beyond Words, that really took it to another level. Of course, took it to another level in a big way, but then Journey Beyond Words, even another higher level. I was just like, wow, to get to that. I was a nervous wreck at that point. I mean, it was so difficult to say, how am I going to be able to really profess this, you know, in the way that I want to? And the journey behind words said, oh my gosh, is this, can I do this? It's so difficult. Scary. Yeah. People think you're completely nuts. And they won't like that. And then to synopsify Journey Beyond Words and to just break it, you know, reduce it all down to, look, I don't know anything. I don't know anything. And I never will. I don't know anything, and I never will know anything. And neither will you. Just profess that. When you profess that, it's the greatest freedom imaginable to just, in this world, to say this in terms of spreading your wings of freedom, spreading the wings of freedom. I don't know anything, and I never will know anything. Plain and simple. So we're really opening the door to the peace of God, that spray on this LED screen, this fake mirror. We're spraying a reflective coating on the fake mirror. We thought was a mirror, it wasn't. It was like an image of a mirror on an LED screen. We thought, oh, we're looking into a mirror. And then they manipulated the imagery on the screen. Once we hooked ourselves on believing it was a mirror. We're seeing, right? So we're spraying a reflective coating on the LED screen, so it actually does seem to reflect a little better, right? Even though what we are can't be reflected because we're freedom. But we can get this equal, imperceptible gentleness, softness, gentle glory. Imperceptible gentle glory. It comes in imperceptibly, and yet it's there. It's the end of the road for this fakery. You know, the jig's up. The jig is definitely up. And so we need to just profess this. I'm professing it. The jig is up, folks. The fourth dimensional folks, the jig is up. Okay? Your cover has been blown. It's been totally blown. Game over. Game over. And again, the momentum of their expectations will keep going for a while, and they'll play out their little, you know, keep playing their little silly games for a while. But the momentum is greatly reduced for them, greatly reduced, which is what I want to do, what Jesus wants to do, and the Dharma Kings want to do. We want to greatly reduce the momentum of expectations for everyone. But, it'll still play out for a while, but a lot less than previously. Without doing this, it would have played out much longer. So we can be in the belly of the beast and laugh about it, you know, games up and it's wonderful and like that. That sends, you know, beautiful waves of grace everywhere. But I'm not going to, you know, be too ostentatious about it. I'm not going to stand in front of the Apple corporate headquarters and say, with a sign saying, game's up, Apple. You know, it's done. We're on to you. Your cover is blown. I could do that. But if I do it, I do it. If I don't, I don't. But we don't need to rub anyone's noses in it. If that's helpful, then it's helpful. But maybe just leaving this area is enough, you know. But they say, no, if you really want to know who you are, you got to stay here because we're showing you who you are. So it's very difficult to leave the Silicon Valley, actually. Once you're here, it's like a trap because everyone here is so self-assured that they're building, they're making a better reflection of what we are, when in fact they're making a worse one. They're manipulating us. It's not really a reflection. It's a trick. So they're saying, well, we know how to trick ourselves even better. So if you want to really know who you are, you can't leave here. You're going into ignorance if you leave here. That's the attitude here. Is everyone outside of the Silicon Valley, the Bay Area, is ignorant. That's what they really believe. Truly they believe that. When you leave here, you feel like all this pressure, like, no, you can't be leaving here. No, you can't go. What are you doing? You're going to be a moron. You're going to fall down into lower realms if you leave here. You know, you feel that psychology arises in your mind is very frightening, actually, quite frightening. They say, we thought you wanted to know who you are, and we're showing you who you are. What are you doing? You'll go crazy. If you don't keep looking at our manipulated fake mirror, you'll go crazy. No, I'll go sane. Of course, they think sanity is crazy because they think that they're making a new reality which will incorporate the old reality, but it'll be clearly evident that it is a subset incorporated within abnormal mind. So they say if you don't understand what the new reality is, abnormal mind, you're not going to be able to function in this new corporate reality we're making. You won't be able to function there. Well, I'll be functioning in the higher realms just fine, thank you. Here comes summer. Dum 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 da dum dum dum. Here comes summer. Dum 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 dum. Ooh, da 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 da. It's like the jingle. The guy that sang that actually went on to be the lead of singing voice for the jingles of the 70s and the 80s. He had this real suave, kind of beautiful sounding voice that I guess played out well for commercial jingles. Can't remember his name, Jerry something. You don't quite feel it yet. It hasn't warmed up enough yet. But I think next week it will. It will. Here in California, and we will start feeling, you know, here comes summer. I mean, we are, after all, starting Monday into May, right? And May in California, in most places, is in northern hemisphere, so to speak, it is definitely a transition into summer. Definitely is. I got a summer shirt on here today, well ventilated. And so getting ready for that. Here comes summer. So by speaking all this, I'm just sort of clarifying what's really happened. What's really happened over the last 60 years here. And again, all thanks to those who have been part of this and continue to be part of it. They have some beautiful friends that have done fabulous job here, really. Fabulous job. I'm certainly aware of the helpfulness of all of you that have reflected back like, yeah, this is great. I love this, yeah. This is, you know, that's a super helpful, super helpful. So I haven't done it alone. I've done it, it's been a collective effort of many, many. So certainly those who did A Course in Miracles and stayed with that, they've been very helpful too. This here is a bit more potent expression. As my job was to really push it as far as it could be pushed here. And again, that's from my previous lifetime's ability to do that. And I mean, I took so much flack in my previous life from a lot of people. I was so problematical to the New World Order that Hitler hated me. I wasn't in the world at this point. I was a German in the Victorian times, and the Germans really loved me. And in World War II, Hitler, as he's rising to power, you know, he hated me. He loved Wagner. Wagner was his idol. And my name was persona non grata, but people. He still had to act like, you know, yeah, he's a great German, and he couldn't, but really, he couldn't stand me. he wanted to ban my music in Germany. Because he was trying to build, you know, he was part of building this new world order of a false reflection of what we are. He was really super into all this technology that was coming into Germany, had a lot of technology from extraterrestrials, from some of the dark adepts, the dark side. so they're really into chemistry and, you know, rocketry and all this kind of stuff. You know, the whole thing, the way the world is now, they were really into that, sort of pioneering that, and I was trying to stop that. So my music and my cultural influence tried to get people to just ignore all that stuff. Don't go into it. Don't go into science and technology. We don't need it. We're going to go into a higher realm and leave all that behind. And so, you know, Hitler and the Nazis, they didn't like that at all. They thought I was a bad influence, you know, upon culture, bad cultural influence, but they had a difficult time saying that openly, because people had so much love and respect for me that he couldn't really, you know, push that too strongly. But he did push it to his close age. It was reported, you know, written down, that he really had a vehement dislike of me. Yeah, I got a lot of cultural flack from the those who were trying to pioneer, you know, bring in this modern nightmare. They said I was a bad influence. I said, no, we need modernism, modernism, not this beautiful classicism that was slower paced. It was beautiful. It was, you know, it was just stop and start smelling the roses, right? And start seeing if you can feel the peace of God everywhere. Trying to paint musical pictures of the peace of God. They didn't want that. They didn't want that. They wanted the Sturm und Drang of Wagner, right? All this physicality, heroic drama, Valkyries, you know, the warrior maidens, and, you know, all this pagan Sturm und Drang, storm and stress and all this kind of stuff. And they wanted this false, you know, really false picture of what we are. They wanted to go back to that and go even worse, in which we are, where we're at now, where we've become extremely deviant, this world, extremely deviant. Worse than even the pagans of you know, Euro-pagans of times of past and all over the world. We're way worse than they were now at this point, this world, way worse. We're going into a much, much darker, those who are going that direction, much, much darker. Someone told me, I just met this man, and he just sort of spoke up and started telling me about television and how terrible what's on. I told him I don't watch at all. He says, well, yeah, I know, because the programs, all this crime programs they have now, there's so many, it's all sex and violence, and the crime stuff is just horrible, you know, what they're showing, actually. And he says, I can't even stomach it. You know, my wife watches it. He says, I can't watch it. And he said, it gives me the creeps. I mean, something's really wrong here in this world. Oh, yeah. Well, right. Yeah. So anyway, I tried to prevent all this. And so I got a lot of heat, a lot of hatred towards me. Like he's persona non grata. And I would speak up. I would speak up my mind directly anywhere in culture and society, and I got, you know, banned more and more and more and more. Denmark banned me. The whole country banned me. I was banned from Denmark. So that, I mean, I had a mouth, you know, that would speak up. So I always respect people who speak up, even if I don't agree with them entirely, you know. Just the fact they have the courage to speak up and get banned, you know, pretty much, you know, England's banning all the people. If you don't say what they want to hear, they'll ban you there. And pretty soon I'll be banned by the whole world. The whole world will ban me. I'm saying, but Spirit is grateful for what I'm doing and understands, like, yeah, and the Dharma Kings are grateful. They understand what's going on. They're not going to ban me from their realms, that's for sure. But the fourth dimensionals will ban me. I remember in the vision I had of the future, I was taken in the future, and this world was reshaped, and the fourth dimensionals terraformed this world. And I was there, I was kind of taking video, and I was looking around, and they said, what are you doing here? Like, what are you doing? We don't want you here. They were very hostile towards me. They didn't want me here in that place. I was just kind of checking out what's going on here, checking out the future. Back, I said, oh, okay, yeah, cool. So I'm not hostile. It's not like I'm, hostile. I just speak the truth and have to put up with the hostility of those who don't like it. But I'm not really hostile towards anyone, because I know what's going on, and we're just all spirit, perfect spirit, free, perfectly free. And none of us know anything at all, and never will. But we're be tricking ourselves by looking in this mirror. We're trying to create abnormal mind. That's all, and we can't. So everyone is still normal. So how can I be hostile to anyone? We're all still completely normal, even though we're pretending not to be. But you still have to speak up. I've become more diplomatic this lifetime than the last one. I've had to become more diplomatic, but I think something is a little bit is lost in being overly diplomatic. It's just that this world is such a lost cause right now in terms of those who are going into a darker realm. They're really pulling, trying to pull us into that. They're already there. They're just marketers, actually. They're just. What's happening is this world's being marketed to. All these tech people are just marketers for the darker realms. And they say, we need help. Help, we need help down here. I mean, it's we still don't quite feel fixated. We got this anxiety, free-floating anxiety. Yeah, that's called freedom. It's called freedom. So they say, we need help down here. Well, no, I'm going to go to a higher realm, and we'll work on Dharma King plan of how to help out. I'm not going to be pulled down into the darker realms, okay? We will strategically bring about synchronicities there in some way, so that we don't get pulled down into it, that's for sure. We're not going to lose sight of what we are in the slightest bit anymore, okay? It's not going to happen. We're done with that. The peace of God will be with us always. May the peace of God be upon you always. Okay. May the peace of God be upon you now, always and forevermore. And we will not lose that. We will not lose that at all. Okay. We will no longer will we ever appear anymore without the peace of God being absolutely upon us. So we will just retire to a place where we work on that, the peace of God. So, and it's just another step, so we can help out those of our spiritual brothers who have gone into a, I use that as a neutral term, though everyone's gone into the darker realm, which who's thinking that they can find an even more clever way to project on this fake mirror to fixate the mind. We are simply preparing ourselves to help them, but in order to help them, you have to be a saint. You cannot go into those realms or help them without being absolutely accustomed to the peace of God being upon your mind. Supremely accustomed to it. So you're not cannot be tricked in any way, because they're very tricky. Okay, and the fourth dimensionals are very devious and tricky. And so you don't want to go in the fourth dimension at all until you are truly established in the peace of God. Truly a true saint, a true saint. A real, 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 true saint. And then I don't know whether you would appear there, or how would you, how, whatever. We'll cross that bridge when we get to it. And you may go in mass in a group around a group of Dharma kings, that kind of thing. I would not advise going in the fourth dimension even as a saint. I would go in as with a Dharma king, with a whole bunch of other saints like Buddha did, Shakyamuni Buddha. Our Jesus Christ with his apostles, Padmasambhava with his 25 apostles, devotees, right? You would do it that way. You would not just freelance it at all. No way. It's very malevolent. Very malevolent. So we to help out, we need to get used to being in the presence of the Dharma kings and other saints. In order to help out any further, we really have to do that. That's how I see it. And for ourselves, we have to accept the peace of God upon our minds. that spray coating, reflective coating the Holy Spirit puts on this fake, you know, mirror that we're used to, called nature. It's a fake mirror, manipulated evidence, imaginary manipulated evidence, and get used to the peace of God. That's what we really need to do. We have to do that in order to help out now down the road. So that's where I'm at. That's what I'm up for. Peace of God. May the peace of God be upon you. And people used to say that here all the time. I mean, you greet someone and say, you know, may the peace of God be upon you and others and upon you too. And still in church, they still do that. But you're supposed to greet. And as you namaste is the same kind of thing. The namaste is sort of like saying, may the peace of God be upon you. They do that in Christianity and Hinduism and Islam. The greetings are supposed to be. And I guess in Buddhism in some way, the bow, may you always dwell in Buddha fields. You know, may your mind be Buddha mind. Buddha mind be upon you. Tashidelic. Not psychedelic, tashidelic. You're supposed to greet one another that way. I mean, what is going on? You know, your culture is so screwed up. It's unbelievable. And so that's to be reintroduced at some point in the fourth dimensionals. This is what you need to do. And as you take the leave, you're leaving someone, I said, may the peace of God always be upon you. And they will respond, and upon you as well, upon all of us. May the peace of God, it's better to say, may the peace of God be upon all of us. Okay, instead of just an individual. It's better to talk in a collective way. May the peace of God be upon us all. And then say, amen. May the peace of God be upon us all. And so you're supposed to use every interaction you have to reinforce familiarity. To reshape your expectations. It's all a game of reshaping expectations. It's a game you play of reshaping expectations. So you have to play that game where you are at, which is culture, which is you're living in the world. You have to play that game, and nobody's playing that game hardly at all anymore, right? It's perfunctory at best. No, it has to come from the heart. You have to be really into the game of really playing it from the heart. You know, may the peace of God be upon us all. May the peace of God be upon us all. And I try, when people say hello, I try to, you know, kind of like that with my hands. But they say, oh, it's weird. Yeah, whoa. You know, I don't want to play that game. So it has to be reintroduced in a powerful way. It has to be reintroduced. You cannot just have bare bones, you know. A Course in Miracles is not enough. That's for teachers of God. Those are very exceptional to be saints to help out later on. But for most of us, it has to be introduced culturally. Our cultural interactions have to be this game. We have to be taught this new game. We used to do it. Of course, you say prayers before every meal, and it should be for after every meal as well. Okay, you should have prayer time as a family, where you spend a half an hour every day together reinforcing. And Christians are still doing this to some extent. I know a Christian church, you know, they're still doing a great job. It's amazing. But they said that they're totally embattled. And he's really pulled down right now. He's being pulled down. He says, man, I just can't take it anymore, this world. I just can't take it. You're supposed to have prayer time every day together as a family and as friends, and then meditative time by yourself, you know, to reinforce more advanced stuff. Like, I don't know anything, and I never will know anything. That's super advanced. Jesus says that's really, when you come to that point, and you can say that, then he says you are truly right at the door of the peace of God. The peace of God is very close to you indeed. And this is true, because I've been able to say this now, profess it. I said it to myself, positive, in a super positive way, yeah. And I'm able to profess it in a super positive way. So the peace of God is very close to me indeed. Very, very close. And it has arisen. It's starting to arise a bit. You know, I'm starting to have glimpses of it more and more. And just, okay, yeah. Peace of God is upon me, wow. I abandon the peace of God, wow. Peace of God is upon me, wow. I abandon the peace of God, wow. and have to, you know, work on that, smooth it out. So at some point, you know, we'll, you know, once we have the peace of God, we'll be aware of the Dharma kings. You know, we will have more and more contact with them as we go along. You know, we may not be quite ready for that yet. I don't know if I'm ready for it or not. I might be. I've been trying. I need to be at some point. Hasn't happened yet. It'll happen when I'm ready for it to happen. So I'm trying to, you know, smooth it out. So we can assure everyone, you know, even the fourth dimensionals, we assure them, yeah, we have your back. We have your back. Don't worry, we have your back. Again, I don't have animosity towards anyone. I have everyone's back. And we have everyone's back. But we're not going to be naive anymore, okay? We've also got our back, too, okay? That's important to realize. By saying I have everyone's back without exception, that also means I have my own back as well. And so you should pray this way. I have everyone's back without a single exception. May all beings be blessed with the peace of God without exception. Buddhists are very good about this. I like the way that they pray. They pray for everyone without any exception. May all beings without any exception be graced with Buddha mind, which is essentially the peace of God, as it pertains to being in the world here, as we're in the world. I like the way all religions pray, and the way Buddhists pray. I love the way that all religions pray. I love the way that Buddhists pray. That how they make sure that it's all inclusive, and that it happened now without any delay. I mean, the way Longchenpa and Padmasambhava, for instance, pray. It's just music to my ears. Yeah, really. I've come across more and more of their prayers and admonitions and for blessings for us, and Padmasambhava, he's just tremendous. Longchenpa, just tremendous. You can feel the love and compassion for everyone, without exception, coming from him, and the absolute confidence that everyone will be redeemed from this false image. You know, the idea of trying to create an image of ourselves and think that that's the new reality, a representation of ourselves, that's the new reality. That's, you know, was just a, you know, a misadventure, basically. So we will be schooled in right prayer, right petitioning, right affirmations, right assertions, to teach everyone so that they can then play that game. And we have to, you know, play the game really well. You have to play it really well. And we have experience with that with the religions of the last, you know, 3,000-4,000 years in this world. You know, it's been playing that game of reshaping our expectations. That's all it is. It's the game of reshaping our expectations. And we have to love the game. It's a necessary game that we have to play. Everyone has to play that game ultimately. And we have to really learn to love that game. I love it. Absolutely, I love it. And so I've kept doing that my whole life here, in spite of most people giving up that game. They just abandon it. And I've continued to play that game. I wish I could play it a lot better, you know, because it's not easy to do, because you can't just go up to people anymore and say, may the blessings may the peace of God be upon you. To look at you like you're an alien. Yeah, really. It's funny, the aliens are normal now in the world, and the normal people of the world are now viewed as aliens here. It's just become completely Orwellian here. It's true. The alien ET ideology now is the norm, especially in the Bay Area, but around the world. You know, the action figures, the kids, to them, that's normal. And if you profess like a Christian or a religious person, they view you like you're some visitor from across the galaxy. Like, what are you doing here? How did you get here? They start interrogating you. Like, where did you get this ideology? Where did you come from? They treat you like you're an extraterrestrial. Seriously, they do. Well, I guess maybe if that's the case, maybe we should become extraterrestrials to then to this world and go to some other realm, since they already view us that way here. I'm used to being viewed that way. What's this big truck here? We've become the new ETs. Yeah, I had some experiences. I went to the experience of a bookstore, and it was around Christmas, and the whole bookstore was shelving was covered with all these action figures and books and everything, and it was all ET oriented. And this is what the kids are viewing themselves, the mirror they're looking into. All these, you know, weird, bizarre reptilian creatures, fighter, you know, warrior, killer creatures, Mothman, you know, Batman, you know, all stuff. All these motifs of superheroes, kind of extraterrestrial imagery. That's what the kids are just like totally into it. Guys wearing robot shirts. I said, why are you wearing a robot shirt? Well, my kid loves that. You know, they're really into roboticism. I saw the robotic vacuum cleaners at Fry's Electronics recently. Chintzy things, you know, so chintzy. I said, wow, this thing's going to break, easily break. But they just have these robot vacuum cleaners just going around the house, you know, cleaning automatically. But the kids are being, you know, being brought up that roboticism is the correct reflection of what we are. And those who are saying, may the peace of God be upon you and all of us without exception, and may that happen without any delay, and may we all be liberated into infinite Buddha fields of bliss. You know, they think, again, you're like either an ET or a lunatic, one of the two, take your pick. What kind of spaceship did you come here on? That's what their ideas are. Like, hopefully you're just visiting here. We don't really say those things here in this world, so maybe you should go back to your world. Well, maybe we should, shouldn't we? Maybe we should. Maybe we should take their advice and go back to our world. Actually, we were just visiting this world. It's a nice place to visit. Wouldn't want to live here. Wouldn't want to stay here. From the heavenly realms. More heavenly realms. But it didn't used to be that way here. See, it used to be this was the norm. You meet someone, you have respect for those who are showing us how to play the game. Since we have to play this game of reshaping our expectations, part of the game is having great veneration and respect. Not awe, but veneration for those who are teaching us how to play this game successfully and effectively. Otherwise, we're just going to keep floundering. You know, and so, you know, if you're in hell and somebody's teaching you how to get out of hell, you know, you better have the skills to pay attention and not interfere with the transmission of the right advice. You know, you're all ears. You're all ears. You're coachable. You're coachable. That's called being coachable. And so you have a lot of respect for the coach, and you don't play mind games with the coach. You say, thank you, coach. And you... Just like baseball players, they have respect for the manager, they have respect for the coaches. If the coaches are really talented, especially if they're younger players, they say, wow, coach me up. You know, this is great, because they want to get to the big leagues. So they're listening, you know, very, with tremendous attention, because this is their ticket to the big leagues, is doing this. Let's say you have a coach who used to be a big league player, a really successful one, and they're teaching like little leaguers or teaching pony leaguers or high school or college players. I mean, those players are listening with rapt attention to what the coach is telling them. They say, because the coach is saying, this is how we do it in the big leagues. This is how you do it. This is what's going to get, this is your ticket. So I'm going to show you how to do it. They're all ears. And they do it. And they realize, wow, this works. I've got the polish now of a professional. This is great. They want that. Where is that in the world now from a spiritual standpoint? Where is this rapt attention of genuine attention, not fake attention in order then to flip the script and seduce, which is the game in this world. You know, I'll be your servant to establish the idea of servitude, and then I'll flip the script. And once you believe in the idea of servitude, that I'm your servant, then I'll flip the script, and then you'll be my servant. That's what the game that's played in this world. That's the really one of the nastiest games there is in this world. So there's a big difference between genuine attention, because you got no choice but to be expert in this game. And the game of I'll pay attention to what you're saying if you then reciprocate and pay attention to what I'm, my game, which is, you know, fake evidence to fixate the mind. No, there's no reciprocation in that way. The direction is one direction towards liberation. It's not reciprocal at all. Jesus pointed this out to me. Very important point that he pointed out. Most people aren't aware of this, but he said it goes in one direction. It does not go in both directions at all. We have no choice but to give up the game of abnormal mind. So the game is to give that up. It is not to just pretend to give it up for a while and then go back to trying to make it work again. And then that's just oscillating. Oscillation never works. Oscillation is not the game. It doesn't work. So the veneration has to be genuine, knowing that I have to do this. That's where genuine devotion and veneration. And fake attention is for those who feel like they don't have to do it. It's just an option. And they're just kind of having fun. Like, oh, this seems like fun for a while to try this game. But again, they expect reciprocation. They should not never expect reciprocation. I will not play the game of oscillation. I will not play the game of abnormal mind. Okay, there's no reciprocation in, as far as you do my game, I'll do your game. That no deal at all with that. No deal. It's like the coach, like a professional coach says, you know, I'll coach you up on how to be a professional baseball player, and the kids say, well, we'll do that. We'll listen to you if you allow us to coach you up at how to be a lousy, unprofessional baseball player. The coach will say, no. Then I'd just have to turn around and you'd have to coach me up, and then I'd say the same thing to you, and then we're just going around in circles. We're not trying to go around in circles, which really ends up being oscillation, which is mental chaos ultimately. That's what we're getting away from. So the veneration means you listen. You really take it to heart what's being said. Not the emotional heart, like I'm emotional about what you said. No, you take it to your core, or meaning you really take it seriously and your attention is really there and you realize, I have to do this. I have to learn this. I have to get this. It's on me. I got to do this. So I got to pay really, I really respect and appreciate this advice, because this is something I have to do. I cannot oscillate and finish the task. It's freedom from oscillation. It's freedom from hope and fear. Freedom from hope and fear. So this is something that we've lost in this culture. We're now in this situation where it's saying, okay, we'll play your game if you then play our game, which is the old trick of, you know, the how it's played out in this world, you know, gender-wise, is the we're playing this, using the genders to play out this trick. The females pretended to be subservient to the males for a while, like servants, and said, okay, we'll be your servants. And what they were doing was they're trying to get the males to believe in servitude, that, okay, you really are just a servant, my servant. And then as soon as then the males accepted this belief that females were their servants, then the females said, okay, so you do believe in that there is servitude. And the men said, yeah, okay. Okay. And then they said, okay, now we're going to be your rulers and you're going to be our slaves, since you believe in servitude, right? So then they are able to flip the script. So right now, men are the slaves of women in this world. They really are. And it was a trick, in this trick that the women pretended to be the servants of men, the slaves of men. But they never were. They never were. And they did it in order to establish males believing that in slavery and servitude. And now they flipped that script. And now men, I asked the guys, like, what are you doing this weekend? Honey-do list? He says, every weekend is a honey-do list. That's all I do. You talk to like a retired man or a man that's got some money or everything, it's 100% honey-do list. They work all week, slave away all week, and then job to make money. And then they go home to the queen, and they've got a honey-do list all weekend long. They're slaves. They're slaves because they got suckered into believing that the women were their slaves, which they never really were, but they pretended to be. So they could then flip the script. So you should never, ever believe anyone is your slave. Because then you're believing in that that the mind can be enslaved, which means you can be enslaved. As soon as you accept otherness, you know, you are also other to them. If someone's other to you, you are also other to them. So the mind is not one. It's very important. This is very, very important to recognize this. So that's why blessings must be expressed to everyone without exception, meaning you are not excluding yourself either. If it's without exception, you're not excluding yourself either. But you must pray in this way for everyone. May all beings without exception be liberated from the terrible ocean of hope and fear. The ocean of oscillation. Believing that, which is still just the incorporation game of, yeah, I'll do your game if you do mine, meaning, okay, I'll accept normal mind, but it can only be accepted within the context of abnormal mind. That's the game that's played here. So there's spirituality is this game that's being played. Spirituality is a game, is the false game. You have to go beyond that. Your attention has to be greater than that of what we call spirituality. I call it the yoga girl thing, but it's really spirituality. It has to be greater than that. It's not fake veneration. Like, I'll be your little fake venerator if you be my little fake venerator. But the goal is to incorporate normal mind within the realm of abnormal mind. They haven't given up the goal of abnormal mind at all. They're just trying to figure out how to incorporate normal mind there. And the Dharma kings know the difference. If you're truly devoted, they will contact you. They know. So that's why I was contacted, because I really, truly know I have no choice but to get free. And so I'm actually, you know, genuinely devoted. So, when I think of like Sri Sri Anandamayi, I'm all attention. I'm the world disappears, and because I know she has advice for me that I have to pay attention to, and I have to get it, and I have to be her. You know, I am her. She is me. I realize that she is me. She's an accurate reflection, as best we can have, of what I really am, of what the mind really is. And so I have to be her. I have to be that. I have no choice but to be that. And so I realize I have to pay attention, you know, serious attention. Serious attention with veneration. You know, is this veneration where, no, this is it. I have to, you know, other stuff. No. This is important. This is really crucial. Really, really crucial. And it's not two games that are going on here. It's not her game and my game. It's her game, you know, which is my game. It's not that I'm paying attention so that she'll pay attention to my game and oscillate. No. Oscillation's out the window. Oscillation is out the window. And so when oscillation is out the window, there's a different feeling. You have a different feeling. There's this higher seriousness. Higher attention, your attention shifts into a one point in this, really. You're super serious. And then you're willing to have your expectations fundamentally reshaped. So you're saying, please, Guru, reshape my expectations, fundamentally reshape my expectations. I'm willing to have my expectations fundamentally reshaped. I'm willing to die right now to my expectations. I'm willing to die, and I am dying. And you feel like you're dying to your expectations. They're all being melted down. And you don't try to revive them. That's genuine devotion, and that's what's required. Genuine devotion is required. Not this gamesmanship. Not the yoga girl gamesmanship. Like, I'll play like your little devotee, and then later on you can play like my little devotee. And I'll incorporate, because then I want to incorporate reality and normal mind into abnormal mind. That's the goal still of spirituality. Spirit has not let go of that. And there's all this pop spirituality in the world. Spirit is just trying to figure out how can we incorporate normal mind into abnormal mind. And they believe that abnormal mind will be the new basis, the new context, the new foundation, the new basis. But they're so noble that they'll allow normal mind to also have a little realm in that, the realm of abnormal mind. But they have to know their place, of course. Normal mind has to know its place, so that they'll then train us to know what its place is. And so the modern spirituality is just a way of trying to train normal mind into knowing its place within the context of abnormal mind. That's all it is. There's a lack of genuine devotion in the pop spirituality, the Facebook spirituality of the day. There really is. If Ananda Mayama says, you know, drop and give me 100, you know, 100 push-ups, you drop and give her 100 push-ups. That's all there is to it. You know, say, thank you, thank you. She doesn't need to learn how to be abnormal. She's not there to reshape her expectations at all. She's there to reshape your expectations, okay? Or same with Jesus. He's here to reshape our expectations. We're not here to reshape his. He doesn't have any expectations. He's free. We're not here to teach Jesus how to be abnormal. He's not here to learn how to be abnormal. We're not the teachers. He's the teacher. He's the coach. He's Coach Jesus. Coach Longchenpa, Coach Padmasambhava, Coach Rama Maharshi, Coach Jamyang, Coach Manjushri, Coach Jesus, coach us up. We're not here to coach him. That's not our role, to coach Jesus. Our role is to be coachable. We're leaving behind our uncoachability. We're leaving behind this delusion that we can have our cake and eat it too. That we can have abnormal, fixate the mind, and still have perfectly free mind within the context of fixated mind. That's what we're trying to do. If we don't see that's completely insane, we'll keep trying to do it. Again, we're trying to fixate the mind. The mind is fixated. And then claim that we can incorporate mind as perfectly free within that mental fixation. Which is the, you know, this dystopia, materialistic dystopia is what they're trying to do. Say, oh yeah, we're free. Look at the freedom we have within this fixated world. We can travel on airplanes and go to resorts and stuff. Wow, we're so free. Yeah. We can text people. Wow, we're so free. So, again, we're trying to fixate the mind so it's not free, so it's crystallized. And everything that it creates is a crystallization. And it's bound by that, and so what? In other words, time. The mind is bound by time and space, process, and form. So it can only be creative within that context. That's called the belief in fixated mind. So the past totally influences what we're creating in the present and in the future. So nothing's fresh. Nothing is free. It's fixated. We're trying to then make that real, and then say to mind that's perfectly free. Utterly free, no such thing as time, space, process, and form. Everything is absolutely fresh in the moment. We're trying to say, oh yeah, you can come in and function that way okay here within the parameters of total fixation. There's no problem with that, yeah. Completely insane. They don't see it, but it's totally insane, of course. What happens then when you try to be free, you end up with mental chaos. That's what I experienced. I said, okay, how do I be free within this context? And you find out that you have to, what you have to, if you try to incorporate both of them, you end up with mental chaos, which is so horrible you cannot continue with it. And then I realized, yeah, okay, this is what, now I have to really profess this and explain it. So this utopia that they're trying to do here, fourth dimensional utopia, is, you know, is insanity. And you won't be happy with it at all. And sure, they say you can, you know, jet travel. You're not happy where you are? Well, look at your freedom, you know, go to Hawaii. Yeah, but the locals hate us. Hey, howly, you know, get off our island. Well, then fly somewhere else. Well, I don't have the money to. Well, you know, be a hedge fund manager then. Well, there's only so many of those. Well, I don't watch television, though. We'll have a movie of going to other places. See how free you are? You can watch a movie going to some other places. Do a virtual reality thing of traveling to Hawaii. And the locals, so, you know, there's no, you don't get hassled, racially hassled there. Yeah, I said, well, that's not quite the freedom that I really want. You know, something tells me I want more freedom. Oh, no, you're very free. Just get on a plane, you can go anywhere. Get in your car, you can drive someplace. No, I'm talking about formless spiritual freedom, perfect freedom. Well, well, you got to accommodate fixation, too. Come on, be fair. Okay, let's oscillate. Let's oscillate. Let's be fair, meaning let's oscillate. Okay, we're fair. We'll show you fair. Ultimate, okay, we'll oscillate. Perfect freedom, perfect fixation. Perfect freedom, perfect fixation. Perfect freedom, fixation. Mental chaos. You're not sure if you're fixated or free. Trying to blend the two together. Trying to blend total fixation and total freedom. Trying to blend that together in your mind, you end up with mental chaos. You know, that's a smoothie that you can't drink. You take one sip of that smoothie, you spit it out. It's like, I can't drink this. No one can. No one can. That's worse than a broccoli juice. 3-day-old broccoli juice. You know, I juiced up a whole bunch of broccoli, and man, I tried drinking that, and I met my match. I couldn't finish it. Because it gives your whole body and breath, it just reeks like this horrible broccoli smell. I mean, it's just like the worst thing ever. That was a fail video. I tried to drink a whole big glass of vial of fresh broccoli juice. That's above my pay grade. Above every, so mental chaos is above our pay grade. It's above everyone's pay grade. It's above God's pay grade, really, right? You cannot abide in that. There's no abidance at all there. I said, uh-oh, there's no home here. So everyone's frantically working on this, trying to make this world a utopia. They really are. But we're getting ready to go to a higher realm, that is for sure. At some point. Reshaping our expectations. It's a game. And we just have to get better and better at that game. Better and better at that game. And we can remain here with the peace of God. Certainly we can. But in terms of really preparing well, it's probably better to go to higher realm to help out the fourth dimensionals, because you know, at some point you have to stop paying attention to what they're doing and realize you kind of get the gist of it, and you got to start preparing to help them. I mean, just observing what they're doing isn't really reshaping our expectations to an extent that we can truly help them. So I've investigated enough. I've seen enough. I don't need to see anymore. I need now to get my groove on with the peace of God. I got to groove the peace of God, because that's what they will need. That's the remedy for them. Doesn't matter, you know, what kind of graphics they throw up on the screen. The remedy is to spray reflective coating of the Holy Spirit on the screen. Always, that's the remedy. So it doesn't matter what realm you go to. That's going to be the remedy in any realm you go to. Doesn't matter what kind of deviance they have. It's the same remedy for all realms. So really, investigating ultimately it's a waste of time. But for me, you know, at some point you realize it's a waste of time. Like, I have the remedy. Doesn't matter. You know, again, the graphics don't matter. The deviant culture, whatever the deviant culture is, the remedy's still the same. Still fundamentally the same. We have to reshape expectations towards the peace of God. So the peace of God has to be there unequivocally, so they can see it and realize it's possible. And you can't give it up. You can't fall prey to their clever little games. Reversal. We'll be your slaves if you then be our slaves. We'll play your game if you play our game. You know, that you can't fall prey to that. You cannot. You cannot. You cannot be a saint and fall prey to that. You cannot be helpful and fall prey to that. So we have to be really grooved with the peace of God. So that's my objective now, and the objective of those who are going in this direction, is to really, we have to really start grooving it. So I'm preparing for that. We'll see, you know, how it goes. I do have to actually work a little bit today, get some more hours. I work hourly. If I don't get enough hours, I'm in big trouble. I'm in big trouble anyway, but that's okay. I'm not really in trouble, because the Dharma Kings have my back. Padmasambhava, I just say to Padmasambhava, guru of action, right? You understand what it's like to take action and get stuff done here in the world. Somehow you managed to do it. So have mercy on those that call upon you, who are dedicated to grooving their mind into the peace of God, as the peace of God. Have mercy upon them so that they may succeed quickly, rapidly, and be great successes at this. So whatever is required to bring this about, bring it about for us here, because Padmasambhava is a mover and a shaker, that is for sure. He moved and shook up all of the greater Tibet, which was a vast region at that time, vast region. It's probably bigger than the United States, the whole region. I don't know. It was big, very large. And he moved it and shook it up. I don't know. When he needed gold, the gold was there. He wanted to build golden stupas, the gold was there to build the stupas. You know, where did they get all that gold, you know? Golden Buddha, I mean, probably just materialized it. At any rate, so I call upon the Dharma Kings to now let us move forward with our venture, which is really the grooving the peace of God, so that we can be helpful down the road to those unfortunate ones that are really straying very badly right now. I don't really want to follow it any longer because it's so pathetic. I feel terrible for them. You know, it's just embarrassing and pathetic. It hurts, you know. When you have compassion, brothers, it hurts to see how their minds are functioning right now. The reflections they're believing in are so lowly that it's painful, quite painful. I don't like to see it. So, but if I have the peace of God, then I'll be realizing there's a definite, certain remedy for them. So that acts as a buffer, and you're able to, with confidence, interact with confidence. But unless you're certain of the remedy, and that you are living example of the remedy, I think this world is too much for us right now. I really do. The fallen state of those, the fall is so severe now that you know, at some point it becomes counterproductive to pay attention to it. It really does. Very counterproductive. And we're pragmatically, we want to be as helpful as fast as possible. And just paying attention to the fall isn't helping in that regard at all. And you know, it doesn't matter how far they fall, the remedy's the same. So we have to apply with certainty to this remedy. That's the real key, certitude, which comes from familiarity. So we have to really put ourselves in places that help us re-support the peace of God, this gentle beauty, soft, gentle beauty everywhere. Imperceptible, though, it's just this imperceptible calm and tranquility and smoothness and grace that just doesn't oscillate at all. There's no oscillation to it. That's very key. There's no oscillation to it. And this protects us from this game of oscillation that they try to tell you. Say, oh, sure, we'll accept what you're teaching if you accept ours. Look how ecumenical, look how fair we are. Fair always means oscillation. Is one way. We cannot fixate the mind. So we must have no choice but to accept this. There's no two ways about it at all. And that's where the rubber hits the road. That's where people freak out here. They don't like that. But that's genuine teaching. Okay. May all beings be blessed by the peace of God this instant. All beings without exception be blessed by the peace of God this very instant. And so that this can grow into a great certitude within us. A great certitude. So that those who have lesser certitude will act as a blessing unto them. So this great chain of blessing takes place until all are liberated from this misadventure, this arrogant misadventure of trying to change the mind, trying to change God. All right. Onward as fast as possible. Wow.